Please join me in our call to worship. From deep within us, we know of a loving presence. All around us, we see glory, beauty, life, and light. Let the people say, "Shine brightly, loving God." We have no words for what we experience, so we cry out, "God." In this moment of worship, may that loving presence grow deeper within us. Let the people say, "Shine brightly, loving God." May we, gathered at this time, learn to pay more attention to you, who loves us at all times and in all places. Let the people say, "Shine brightly, loving God."
Let us be in a spirit of prayer. God, you call us from our daily routine into this sacred time. You call us from our individual paths and plans to be a community and a spirit that embodies your presence in the world. You call us from the anxieties of our lives into the transforming grace of your love. God, help us to center ourselves in your presence as we worship today, and open us to your word that it may shape and empower us for the week ahead. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, hello, all my young friends. I want to wish you a very happy morning. I hope you're really good wherever you are. I still miss you, and I can't wait till we're back at the church so we can be together again. It's coming, I promise. It might be for a little while, but we're all going to have our special times together again, down on the floor and on the steps. So let's pretend we're there. And I was going to ask you this question today. Today we're going to talk about one of our favorite stories from the Bible. It's Jonah. And for some of you who know this story, you know that Jonah gets swallowed by a big fish, a whale, we're told. Now, my question is, do you know why Jonah was in the whale? Maybe some of you did, and maybe you know the answer. For those of you who don't, here's why Jonah ended up in the whale. God came to Jonah and asked Jonah to do something. He told Jonah to go to this city, and this city was filled with people that Jonah didn't like. They were people that weren't behaving well. And God said to Jonah, I want you to go to that city, and I want you to tell them that they have to start to act better, otherwise they're going to get punished. Just like if your mommy or your daddy said, you know what, if you don't stop doing that, there's going to be a consequence. So, this is what God asked Jonah to do, and Jonah doesn't want to do it because he doesn't like these people. But it's God who's asking him, so he kind of has to go, but he tries all sorts of things to get out of going, and one of them is getting on this boat on the way to this city, and this storm comes up, and he jumps overboard. And when he jumps overboard, this fish swallows him up. But the fish dumps Jonah off on the shore on the way to this city, so Jonah doesn't get out of it. So Jonah goes to this city, and he goes in there, and he sees all these people, and he kind of grumbles, act better, hoping that they really don't listen to him, and probably thinking that they won't, but guess what? They do. The people in this city actually listen to Jonah, and the king says, if we don't act better, God's going to punish us, so let's be better. And they change their ways of being. They change their ways they're acting, and God's happy. Just like your parents get happy when you change how you're behaving if you're not acting so good, right? And then you don't get punished because you're being good. That's just what God does. And you would think that that would make Jonah happy, but it doesn't. Jonah goes outside that city and he sits under a tree and he has a temper tantrum and he sulks. And he's so upset that these people actually acted better. And that's how the story ends. Now, what do you think of Jonah? Do you think Jonah should have been happy because a whole city ended up being filled with much better, nicer people? And everybody was happy, including God. And the only person who wasn't happy was Jonah. What do you think? Is Jonah right for sitting under that tree or grumbling? Or maybe is there something Jonah needs to learn about something we call grace, which is when God says to all of us, bad people in bad cities like the one Jonah went to, people like you, people like me, and says, you know what? I know that sometimes you make mistakes and you don't act the best way that you could, but I love you and I'm going to give you a chance to be better. And when we are better, nothing bad happens. God's happy, we're happy, everybody's happy. So why would we be like Jonah and go under a tree and sulk? Makes no sense to me, but people do. People do. So today's story about Jonah, though the whale is the part everybody remembers, today's really all about when other people get forgiven by God. Shouldn't we be happy? Because when we don't act so great and God forgives us, wouldn't we want other people to be happy for us too? Don't you think? I think so. So, help other people be better, and be happy for them when they are. And every time you are the best version of you, we'll all be happy for you too. And I will see you soon. Bye, everybody.
And now together, let us say the prayer that Jesus taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Hear the word of God this morning from the prophet Jonah in chapter 3. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you. So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk, and he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When God saw what they did, how they turned away from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Our gospel reading for this Sunday morning is from Mark's gospel. Here in chapter 1, verses 14 through 20, Jesus calls his first disciples. After John was put in prison, Jesus went into Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God. "The time has come," he said. "The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news." As Jesus walked beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the lake, because they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people." At once they left their nets and followed him. When he had gone a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John in a boat, preparing their nets. Without delay he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
Just the other night, we sat in our living room and watched one of our very favorite movies, The Princess Bride. And it's one of our favorite movies for a whole bunch of reasons, and I know a bunch of you out there love that movie. If you've never seen The Princess Bride, you must. As soon as this sermon is over, go watch it. It's one of the most beautiful, wonderful, funny, lovely movies you'll ever see. And one part that relates to our story with Jonah today is Fred Savage's character of the little boy who's sick in bed, who's being read this story by his grandfather. And the moment in the movie when his grandfather tells him that the bad guy, Prince Humperdinck, in the movie, doesn't have anything bad happen to him, that he lives. The little boy thinks there's going to be this epic sword battle or something, and the bad guy's going to die. And when he finds out that that's not what happens, and that Prince Humperdinck lives, the little boy gets very upset and wonders why his grandfather's even reading him this story in the first place. It's a waste of time if the bad guy doesn't get his due. And it's such a human moment in the movie, which is filled with lots of human moments, but at some degree, at some level, we all resonate with that. We like to see the bad guy in the book, the story, the movie, the play, get their due in the end. But what happens when those people honestly do what the Ninevites do today, and they repent? We heard a lot of words about repentance through Advent from John the Baptist, and Jesus as well, preaching a gospel of repentance, of turning away from one way of being, leaving it behind, and with an authentically repentant heart and repentant spirit, turning in a different direction and moving forward in a better, more God-directed way. That's what repentance is. And we have the ability to have repentant moments all the time. We are always given the opportunities to turn away from certain ways of being, certain ways of living, leave them behind, honestly repent, and say, from this moment forward, I'm going to go this way, and I'm going to be and act this way, and it's going to be better than I was before. And live that life. The story of the Christmas Carol and Scrooge is the perfect example of that. He has a repentant evening with three spirits, and on awakening on Christmas morning, he leaves the old Scrooge behind and becomes a new Ebenezer that is beloved by the city and a second father to Tiny Tim. It's redemption. And we should be inspired by redemption stories. And sometimes we are. And sometimes we're like our friend Jonah, who reluctantly goes to deliver this message of warning and of repentance, and upon finding that, lo and behold, the Ninevites actually listen to him, and do authentically repent and become a better people and a better city, it drives him nuts. And he sulks about it. And that's where the story ends. Out there, under the tree, outside the city, sulking Jonah because people actually shaped up. He wanted the bad guys to get it in the end, and God wasn't working that way. It harkens to a parable that Jesus shared about workers in a vineyard and how even those who come to work very late in the day receive the same payment as those who'd been working hard all day. No matter how late in the game you come to God, no matter how late in your life you make these changes and authentically move in a new and different direction, you are able to receive the same amount of fullness of grace that those who've been doing it far longer received in full measure as well. And that's a gift and something we shouldn't take for granted, because that's a message of hope for those moments when we find ourselves not being the best version of ourselves that we can be and falling back into bad patterns and bad habits, and knowing that there's the ability to authentically repent and receive God's grace. The trick, though, about the Jonah story is that it's really about how much we're like Jonah. How often are we not authentically glad when people receive the grace of God? When people actually take the time to improve and become something more and something better, and we've been working so hard at it for so long, and we go to church and we do this and we do that, and they just sort of show up and suddenly everything's good? Yes, with God. And we should be thankful for that, because that's extended to us too. We are, none of us, any better, any more righteous, any more true than anybody else in this world. And we should give prayers of thanks that God gives the full measure of God's grace, no matter when we find that it is time for us to have a moment of turning toward a better way. People around you may not get it. People around you may not think you deserve it, but that's not for them, for us to decide. That's God's business. And Scripture tells us that God delights in those moments, no matter when they happen, that we figure it out, that we listen to the Jonahs around us, that we, like the Ninevites, say, hey, you know what? It's time to shape up. It's time to turn a page. It's time to close that chapter, write a new one, a better one. We can do this personally. We can do this corporately. But what we should always be on the guard about is not being a Jonah about it when people do it. We shouldn't be Fred Savage in Princess Bride about Prince Humperdinck. We should celebrate and figure it out that this is one more person, one more group of people that are now part of a larger human family of understanding and compassion, that have journeyed through something that gives them a broader and deeper view of themselves and the world and allows them to see how we can together authentically be better people, better communities. Unless you go through those repentance moments sometimes, you honestly don't have a full and authentic understanding and empathy of that. But when you do, your life changes. And you're able to more authentically celebrate when it happens to others. We don't know anything about Jonah's repentant moments. Maybe he's due one, especially after this time under the tree outside the city. but it's a wonderful story. Everybody knows the whale, but as I shared with our young people earlier in the video, this story really isn't anything about the whale. It's about Nineveh and the people there. And although Jonah is reluctant to bring this message, God wants them to hear it. And God celebrates the Ninevites' repentance, and Jonah doesn't. And that's a cautionary tale about how we should never want to be like Jonah. Because when God comes to us and taps us on the shoulder and says, it's time to turn a page, time to take stock and look in the mirror a little bit and do things a little differently, and we do, wouldn't we want people to celebrate with us? And should we not all the more celebrate with them when they do as well? Something to think about. Amen.
Each week we share joys and concerns in our family of faith. And today it is a great joy to report that Debbie Graves' cancer is in remission. We celebrate with you, Debbie, and we thank God. This morning I lift up in concern Theo Webster. On Thursday, Theo's mother, Alma Webster, died. So I ask that during this week and in the weeks to come, you hold Theo and her son Bill and their family members in your thoughts and prayers. Today I lift up in gratitude all of those who are working so hard to get the COVID vaccine to all of us. And of course, we pray for our new government leaders. We pray for their wisdom. We pray for their health and safety, that they might lead us well. We pray now after a moment of silence. God, as we walk the path in a new year, we thank you for new beginnings. The world turns and seasons change. They bring a new look, a new feel, and new opportunities. But also, God, you give us new seasons within. As the loving Father welcomed his prodigal son home to start again, your grace delivers us from past missteps and mistakes and invites us to become new. We thank you, God, for making all things new. And we ask you for new reasons to hope in this year. May the shadow of COVID, under which we have lived for too long, now recede, and may we find a new normal that will energize and renew each one of us. May the worries and grief that have weighed heavily upon us now lift as we trust your message of comfort and joy and embrace the truth that you are always with us. God, we continue to ask for your protection for all healthcare professionals and all other essential workers. They put themselves at risk for the sake of others. We recognize their Christ-like mission, and we pray for their safety and health. As a new president and many new leaders in our government begin their work, we ask you to grant them wisdom, that they may sincerely listen to the needs of all people and act with fairness and compassion for the good of all Americans and our global partners. And finally, God, we ask you to bless and empower your church. This world is in great need of a living example of your wisdom, your compassion, and your grace. May we be that example as we fulfill our calling as friends of Jesus, the body of Christ, your faithful people. Amen.
Our invitation to offering. Gestures of gratitude are a demonstration that a blessing or benefit has been received. We heard a call, dropped our nets, and came to this place to find a new life. The gifts we give today are but tokens of the blessings of the new life we live in Christ. bring your gifts with joy, for they remind us of just how blessed we are to know this love that flows so generously from the Spirit of God. We thank you for your continued support of the Church through your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings. You can make those now here on this page with the Donate Now button, or you can send them, mail them to the church office. Thank you so much. May God bless you, keep you safe and healthy. Amen.
Consider all the works thy hand hath made. I see the stars, I hear the mighty thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sing to my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art. How great thou art. Then sing to my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art.
Now, as we leave this time of worship together, may the one who is faithful to all be with us all as we depart this blessed time. May we be a blessing to every place we go until we gather again. Amen.